Hello, everyone, and welcome to Pick Your Poison, Climate, Disease, and Human Disaster from the Middle Ages to Today. My name is Stephanie Carlson, though many of you probably know me better as Cur de Leon on r/AskHistorians, and I will be your moderator for today's panel and roundtable discussion. This panel will primarily focus on historic responses to environmental disasters and epidemics, as well as our methods for studying those events from the present. We will touch on themes of political upheaval, xenophobic violence, and the marginalization of the disempowered in the historical record. However, we will also discuss the challenges of studying those events from the present and the constant changing ways that we categorize our sources. And now, with great pleasure, I can introduce you to our first speaker for the day. Dr. Christopher S. Rose received his PhD from the University of Texas at Austin in 2019. He is currently an adjunct instructor in global studies at St. Edward's University in Austin, Texas, and he will be presenting his paper, The Importance of Epidemics for Social History.
Thank you, Stephanie, and thanks to the organizers for putting this together. This is a really awesome way to get public history out there as a field. In this short presentation, I want to give some insight into what I do, which is the historical subfield of the social history of medicine. Medical history is a broad field, is concerned with the history of disease, the development of medical treatments, and the progression of scientific knowledge. Within that field, other historians have begun to explore these themes as avenues to explore social history through the history of medicine and disease. And to me, this is a really exciting development that's opening up interesting insights into parts of society that may not have left records of their own. Since we're in the middle of the COVID-19 pandemic right now, I want to work specifically with what's important and interesting about epidemics for the study of social history, but what I'm saying here can also apply to environmental disasters. But for the sake of keeping to within the time limit, I'm going to focus on epidemics. So epidemics are social events that are based around medical emergencies. In scientific terms, a disease outbreak is considered to take place when a higher than expected number of cases and deaths occur from a given disease. This is why, for example, the appearance of the plague in New Mexico and Colorado this summer isn't attracting much attention, except in the media. There are around 100 cases every year, and plague is easily treatable with antibiotics now. COVID, on the other hand, was an entirely new disease that could not be treated. An outbreak becomes an epidemic when that higher than average number of cases is happening in multiple locations. Pandemic is a portmanteau of global epidemic, and it's used to convey the idea that the epidemic is occurring in multiple geographic non-contiguous regions of the globe. Now, if we consider that a virus is a little bit of genetic coding in a protein shell, and that its sole purpose in existence is to invade a host, to cause cellular mutation, replicate, and be passed on to the next host, then what exactly is the difference between an epidemic and a virus trying to get the MVP of the Year award? In 1960, the historian Roger McGrew suggested that the answer was the social component. Writing about cholera, he proposed the idea that epidemics follow a set pattern of social events, similar to a dramatic storyline. In the time since McGrew wrote, other social historians of medicine have identified different stages of an epidemic event. But one of the things that this has done is it's given historians a series of things to start looking for in the historical record whenever an epidemic is recorded. So the stages that McGrew identified are, first, denial. Denial that the disease in question is even occurring. People will probably recall right now that COVID-19 was dismissed early on as just the flu. During the first global cholera epidemic in 1832-1833, cholera arrived in North America by way of Canada, and it was transmitted down the Hudson River, eventually arriving in New York City. While the New York Medical Society announced the first cases of the disease, they were attacked by people who felt that the announcement was premature and unwarranted. In particular, the city's business and political leaders refused to acknowledge the disease because the imposition of a quarantine would have severely harmed the city's economy. It took 6 weeks for the city's Board of Health to officially recognize the outbreak, which almost certainly made it worse. The second stage is blame. Something or someone is blamed for the disease. Obviously, right now, there's a lot of finger-waving, finger-pointing at China over COVID. As many other historians have pointed out, this builds on a very long history of anti-Chinese sentiment in the United States that goes all the way back to the first wave of immigration in the mid-19th century, which is built around the idea that the Chinese are, quote-unquote, dirty, that they're unhygienic, that they carry disease. And this is a very old phenomenon. The Black Death was attributed in parts of Europe to Jews. It was said they were poisoning wells, and many of them were burned at the stake in response. Later, during the third plague pandemic in the 1700s, it was said that the plague must have come from the East. Professor Nuchet Varlik, who is at Rutgers, has written about this because she's an Ottoman historian, and it built on European suspicions and distrust of the Ottoman Empire because, again, it was said that people in the East did not share European understandings of health, hygiene, and care of the body. So not only were they disease-ridden, but apparently they were too stupid to understand it. Similarly, cholera, when it began to spread in the 19th century, was specifically attributed to India, which built on imperial European understandings that Africa and Asia were dangerous places for white bodies. The third stage is uncertainty. When a new disease arises, you have a combination of a public that wants answers and a medical profession that is just as uncertain about the provenance and effective treatment of the disease as everyone else. As a result, society views physicians and medicine of the time as having failed. This often leads to the rise of alternative treatment therapies, many of which are not only not effective, but are actually harmful. In earlier times, we called such people quacks. Going back to cholera again, we can also see that this tends to lend itself to political purposes. During an outbreak in Egypt in 1883, I specialize in Egypt, the British Surgeon General, Sir Guy Hunter, went to Egypt to oversee the investigation into the origins of the outbreak, which he had already decided would be found in Egypt. You see, the British were very interested in keeping trade from India open, and this would have meant a blockade on British trade to and from the subcontinent. When Robert Koch, the German scientist, announced the following year, 1884, that his team, which had been working in Egypt during the same outbreak, had discovered the causal agent of cholera, what we now know as Vibrio cholerae, the British Health Ministry basically denounced Koch's discovery as fake news. Fourth, policy. Epidemics stimulate a variety of new laws, sometimes emergency laws, to get things under control and to prevent this sort of thing from happening again. Initially, these laws are viewed as immediately necessary to prevent or control an epidemic, but often remain in effect long after the epidemic has subsided. This goes hand in hand with the idea that the state is responsible for guarding public health. Legislation is seen as proactive. For example, during the SARS outbreak in 2009, the Egyptian government used the opportunity to order the slaughter of pigs. This was seen as proactive because the disease was erroneously labeled swine flu. And this met with approval from many Egyptians who are convinced that pigs were carriers of the disease. However, the underlying rationale was to deprive a particular demographic that lived in a squatter neighborhood on the outskirts of Cairo their livelihood and to force them to move. What these four trends also illuminate in the historical record are moments of social disturbance when normal people, and by which I mean non-elite people, about whom histories tend not to be written because they were often illiterate and left no written records of their own, make themselves and their wishes known. For historians, these moments are important because finding these people in the historical record is otherwise rather difficult. Usually what we have of them are descriptions by others, and from our particular vantage point in their future, it's questionable whether we can try to understand their feelings, concerns, and motivations. It's moments like these moments of crisis, when they're making their own demands and expressing the limits of their tolerance. These expressions don't necessarily have to be about disease. The epidemic event or the environmental event or what have you is more of a straw that breaks the camel's back. It marks the point at which people can no longer just put up with it, but feel compelled to act out and say something. To take the current moment, for example, to what can we attribute the success of the Black Lives Matter protests in the summer of 2020? They're happening amidst the COVID-19 outbreak, which seems almost counterproductive. But if you think about COVID as a breaking point, a lot of people are already frustrated with the government for what they see as a bungled response to the pandemic. They're sitting at home, they're watching the news, and the BLM protests are providing an outlet for these long simmering frustrations we've seen in some form or another for decades. We can't protest COVID. Demonstrating in front of a hospital would be counterproductive, for example, but we can use this moment to introduce other issues that are plaguing our society. So, for example, the Russian Revolution had its roots in disease and starvation that took place during World War I. Yes, the leadership had been pushing for revolution for years, but why that particular moment? Similar uprisings took place after the war in Ireland, Egypt, and India, each of which were used as sources of human and natural resources for Britain's war effort. So, to wrap up my remarks, what we're doing with this panel is that each of us is, in our own way, describing how different levels of society have reacted to historical crises that span this gap between medical or environmental history and social history, and exploring what the record shows, or sometimes does not show, which, as we'll talk about over the course of this panel, is sometimes equally as important for historians to consider.
Thank you so much, Christopher. Next, I want to introduce Daria Berman. Daria earned her MA from the University of Chicago and her BA from New York, and she will be presenting her paper, The Anti-Jewish Riots in the First Castilian Civil War.
The study of anti-Judaism in Iberia uncovers riots, mass conversions, and blood libels, to name just a few. Medieval anti-Judaism refers to a hatred of the religion of Judaism, as in the case of polemical debates. However, viewing this violence as exclusively religious strife between Christians and Jews limits our understanding of the attacks against the Jews that were motivated by rebellions against monarchs, war, economic downturns, and pandemic. My research is on the Black Death and the riots against the Jews in the First Castilian Civil War between King Pedro I and Enrique de Trastámara in the 14th century. There are not records that indicate anti-Jewish attacks blaming Jews for the Black Death in the Kingdom of Castile, whereas there are many instances in the Kingdom of Aragon, for instance. Nonetheless, anti-Jewish riots did occur during the Civil War. I argue against the widespread scholarship that attributed the riots to Enrique de Trastámara's alleged anti-Jewish propaganda. Instead, anti-Judaism during the Civil War could not be limited to Enrique, as Pedro I continued the legacy of Iberian monarchs in exploiting Jewish courtiers, moneylenders, and tax collectors, which heightened animosity towards the Jews and in the end erupted into riots. Now, asking questions about whether the causes for the riots against the Jews were anti-Jewish may seem to be a simple question. Since rioters killed Jewish people, why would these attacks not be anti-Jewish? Nonetheless, asking which aspects of these riots were anti-Jewish actually can help guide research on forming a more complete picture of the perpetrators. For instance, the main focus of research on the Civil War focuses on the rebel armies of Enrique de Trastámara. By opening up our investigation of who caused the riots, we can also see how Pedro I and his armies also contributed to these attacks, both literally with English allies of Pedro I attacking the Jewish neighborhoods, and also in the more insidious nature of the relationship between the monarch and the Jewish people. First, a contextualization of the study of medieval Iberian monarchs and their Jewish subjects. It is important to keep in mind two factors. Number one, medieval Iberian monarchs did promise protection for their Jewish subjects. However, Jewish subjects had to pay for this privilege. This protection by the monarch did not guarantee complete safety for Castilian Jews, who were still harassed and murdered, as we see in the riots of the Civil War. Second, while there are many instances of grievances against Jewish courtiers, moneylenders, and tax collectors, none of these professions were monopolized by Jewish workers. In fact, Jews were minorities in these professions. Most of the Jewish population in Castile and Aragon were small shopkeepers and craftsmen. It is due to the special relationship between the monarch and the Jews that these grievances are so common, as complaints against the monarch could be expressed through violence and verbal attacks against the Jews. Why? Because the Jews employed in money lending, taxes, and advisor positions were considered the king's property. And in these cases, attacks on the Jews could delay interest payments on debts paid to the crown and taxes. This is not just a process created by the Castilian populace, but also to an extent encouraged by the monarch in granting delays in interest payments on debts after Castilian tax against Jewish moneylenders. There are economic factors, and similarly, we need to consider social factors, in this case, the Black Death, which swept through the Kingdom of Castile in 1348. By 1350, King Pedro I inherited Castile, which his father, Alfonso XI, had recently expanded after a series of battles against Muslim territories, known as the Reconquista. Even before Pedro I came to the throne, the hardships of the Black Death, both demographic and economic, temporarily stopped the Reconquista. Instead, Pedro I struggled to respond to the inflation of rents and wages caused by the Black Death, causing hardship for landlords and workers. Pedro I also disputed with dissenting nobles who demanded Pedro I intervene in dividing the seigneuries in which peasants could choose their lord, a specific type of Spanish feudalism in which nobles were competing to have more limitations in which nobles could receive their feudal privileges, but Pedro I refused. The resulting dissension from the nobility and protests from the general Castilian populace provided this opportune time for Enrique de Trastámara to wage war against King Pedro I. The focus of my research includes the methods and strategy that Enrique used to defeat Pedro, as well as the attack on the Jews of Castile during the Civil War. Enrique challenged Pedro I's claim to Alfonso XI's legacy, lineage, and expansion of the centralization of the monarchy. The scholarship on the First Castilian Civil War tends to center the attacks on the Jews as the main reason for Enrique's support. However, by studying the available chronicles, the information on why the attacks on the Jews occurred do not point towards an explicit attack on the Jews, but an overlap of violence against Pedro I. First, how did Pedro contribute to aggravating Jewish-Christian relations, especially at the forefront of economic downturns? The resistance against tax collection and repaying debts to debtors became fraught with grievances against the monarch and his Jewish subjects. We can see this in turning to the Cortes or Parliament petitions of 1348 and 1351, in which complaints against taxation and money lending accused Jews of inflating interest rates. These grievances in 1348 led to the suspension of Jewish money lending by Alfonso XI, which would be reversed only 3 years later under Pedro I in 1351. This prohibition reversal reflects a pattern of medieval monarchs in giving in to anti-Jewish rhetoric and condoning anti-Judaism as a coded language of rebellion against the monarch. Now, when we look in the reign of Enrique de Trastámara, or Enrique II, he experiences similar Cortes petitions in the 1360s, which demand, again, a switch from Jewish to only Christian moneylenders. Enrique, in this case, refuses. This raises another question. Why would Enrique, who allegedly participated in anti-Jewish propaganda, follow the exact same pattern as his predecessors in protecting the Jews? Nonetheless, by accepting that Enrique, once king, would of course follow in the fashion of his predecessors, it is not surprising at all that the typical medieval monarch rejection of this reversal points to a tradition of unbalanced exploitation and protection of Jews for the purpose of the crown treasury. Reflected in the first-hand accounts of the riots of the Castilian Jews, the riots occurred from a lack of protection from the monarch and from Christian animosity towards a misconception of this relationship between the monarch and the Jews, not as a privilege, but as a paid protection at the expense of Jewish exploitation. A final bridge into anti-Judaism and kingship. In the Royal Chronicle of Pedro I, the author produces unsettling challenges to Pedro I's lineage, claiming Enrique, albeit an illegitimate child of Alfonso XI, is more like Alfonso XI than the heir Pedro I. This chronicle is reinvented over time with anti-Jewish language, spreading rumors that Pedro I is not even the true son of Alfonso XI, but an illegitimate son of a Jewish mother. Unearthing the reason for this shift in the account of the Civil War emphasizes an increase in anti-Judaism during Enrique's reign. While the anti-Jewish propaganda during Enrique's battles against Pedro I cannot be proven given the source material, there is a clear instant increase in anti-Judaism that suggests Castilians' negative shift in understanding the Jews' royal service to the king. Comparing literature written against the nobility for the suffering of the peasantry during Alfonso XI's reign, in contrast to Enrique II's reign, which blames the Jews, is a clear indication of a significant shift in the perception of the king's Jewish servants and the exploitation by the monarch, creating increased vulnerability of the Jews, spreading anti-Jewish violence as a rebellion against monarchs. Thank you for listening. And also, I want to thank the archivists at the National Historic Archives in Spain for their guidance in tracking down sources. And thank you, Ask Historians, and thank you for listening.
Thank you, Daria, for that paper. Now I want to introduce Adam Bierstead, our next speaker. Adam graduated with his MA in Viking and Medieval Norse Studies from the University of Iceland in 2019, and he will be presenting his paper, Galt Margr over Thurthessa Ofrithar, the Somalis Eruption, Unusual Weather, and the End of the Icelandic Commonwealth.
Excellent. Thank you, Stephanie, for that introduction, and thank you to Ask Historians for organizing this conference. Before we get started, I also want to thank Dr. Emily Lethbridge at the Arni Magnusson Institute for Icelandic Studies, who is my MA advisor, which that project my paper today is based on, and without her, it would not be possible. So my paper turns away from epidemics to look at a different sort of environmental crisis, of volcanism. It deals with the end of the so-called Icelandic Commonwealth, a society unlike any other in medieval Europe. So before getting into the meat of the analysis and how disruptive weather and the resultant famine and disease impacted Iceland, it's worthwhile to give a very brief introduction to the political context of the late 1250s. Iceland, since its settlement in the 9th century, was legally a society with no executive ruler. Instead, a complex network of regional chieftains and judges managed the feuding farmers, and all cases brought to either the district courts or to the yearly Althingi would be judged by a panel with some similarity to a modern jury. This system starts to disintegrate in the 1180s, as wealth accumulated in the hands of a few families, most prominently the Sturlungar, the descendants of Fam Sturla, including the very famous Snorri Sturluson, who wrote the prose Edda of Norse mythology, and the Hoikdailir, the descendants of Jon Lofsson, particularly Gizur Thorvaldsson. The various factions of the families fought for several generations while the Norwegian king attempted to annex Iceland through the work of one faction. This so-called Sturlunga Old, or Sturlung Age, continued until Gizur Thorvaldsson was appointed Jarl of Iceland by King Haakon IV in 1258, and the elites agreed to the annexation by the Norwegian crown in 1262 and again in 1264. Despite the political strife, this is also a period of intense cultural production, including some of the most famous Icelandic sagas and contemporary history in the form of both sagas and annals, either produced in the period or within the next century afterwards. The most valuable is written by Snorri Sturluson's nephew, Sturla Thordarson, a so-called Íslendinga saga. However, we also have another relevant saga, Thorgils saga Skarda, and eight annals from throughout the Middle Ages, though some of these borrow from each other. So the environmental crisis that overlays this political strife is the Somalis eruption dating from either 1256 or 1257. This is, however, not an Icelandic volcanic eruption. It is instead on the other side of the world in Indonesia. So to simplify the science greatly, a large enough volcanic eruption can influence global weather. Particularly operative are the sulfate gas aerosols, which can disperse in the stratosphere and wreak havoc on regional weather systems across the world for between 2 and 10 years following the eruption. Somalis appears to be one of the largest single eruptions of the past 2,000 years, so is definitely big enough. Two questions then emerge that this paper will address. Was Iceland affected by this eruption, and how did Icelanders respond to this crisis? In order to be transparent about how I conducted my analysis, I take a primarily literary approach to the two saga sources, Íslendinga saga and Þorgils saga Skarda. These are supplemented with analysis of the 8 medieval annals from Iceland. Older annals are prioritized over younger ones, and if the same event shows up with different phrasings in multiple annal sources, that is taken to be more likely to be accurate than a single phrasing that is borrowed from annal to annal. To more fully construct annual weather patterns, I also use the weather data available from the 1816 eruption of Tambora, which had quarterly weather reports submitted to the Danish throne from each district in Iceland. Despite Tambora's geographic and magnitudinal similarities with Somalis, both are Volcanic Explosivity Index 7 eruptions, this serves only as a rough approximation. It is not a substitute for a full climate model reconstruction, as I'll talk about more in a few minutes. The traditional date of the eruption of Somalis is 1257 CE, though there is ongoing debate on the dating. Still, 1257 is where my analysis begins. There is, however, an Icelandic eruption of the volcano Katla in 1262, marking the end date of my checking for impacts. So, year by year, the weather of the winter of 1257 into 1258 was very harsh. An epidemic ravaged Miðfjörður in northern Iceland, killing approximately 400 people. Additionally, Thorkell Sagaskarða describes the weather as follows, quote, "The weather to them seemed so bad that men knew of none similar to it. That would be a similarly harsh spring," end quote. However, by August, when Gizur Thorvaldsson sailed from Norway to Iceland, the weather appears pleasant. This is consistent with the weather impacts from Tambora, which have a harsh spring, but a hot August. 1259 has peculiar weather as well. Henrik Hoyer's annal tells of a snowstorm in August, though the location is not mentioned. Additionally, according to Skalholt's annals and the Annales Regii, there is a landslide in Búðardalur. There may be famine, according to Flateyjarbókar annál, but the only source to say that comes from the 1380s, and so we can't necessarily assume it was widespread or happened at all. 1260 is relatively quiet, but 1261 is a very bad year. Sea ice surrounds Iceland until Easter, something mentioned in Íslendinga saga and every single annal source. This is extremely harsh, and Gizur Thorvaldsson has to announce a new assembly and water fast as a way to get the weather to improve, indicating some belief in divine displeasure. So, to answer my first question, can we say that these weather events are related to the Somalis eruption? Well, for the first year, likely yes. Comparison of pan-European records shows that 1258 had significant cooling and crop failures. This eruption, however, appears to have had very few long-term effects across Europe, and so 1259 was much more pleasant in France, for instance. Europe demonstrates no four-year impacts from the eruption. This does not necessarily mean that the 1261 ice sheet is unrelated, though. It simply means that I would need more research and modeling than my methodology allows to determine how closely Icelandic weather in this period stuck to continental Europe's. However, I want to be clear, it doesn't entirely matter. Regardless of whether an Indonesian volcanic eruption was a primary cause of these weather events or not, and I certainly hope it was, they did happen, and people had to deal with that pain. Sadly, in Iceland, the people with social power did not deal with it well. I mentioned the 1261 water fast already. This is one tool common people had to deal with abnormal experiences. While in this time period, in the narrative sources, witchcraft is never blamed, unlike in other saga genres, awe and appeasement of divine anger does occur. However, what I wish to focus on in this talk is the response of the wealthiest Icelanders, because the narrative of Íslendinga saga focuses on them. Unfortunately, with that lens, it becomes clear that despite the severity of the abnormal weather, Gizur Thorvaldsson and Sturla Þórðarson ignored it unless it was expedient to their ideological goals. To rewind to 1258, while Thorkell Sagaskarða mentions the epidemic in Miðfjörður, Íslendinga saga does not, even though the latter's author was present during those events. Sturla was chasing his cousin's killer in the region at that time period. Sturla, however, is writing a history of the consequences of the burning of Gizur's farm at Flugumýri in late 1253. Thorkell's Skarði's death, even though Thorkell's was Sturla's cousin, does not fit into that. Gizur at the time was still in Norway. 400 poor farmers don't matter in the face of the political battles that his history is focusing on. 1261's presence in the narrative of Íslendinga saga can be explained similarly. Gizur does acknowledge the ice sheet and takes actions to deal with it. He swears to a monthly assembly and a new water fast. And once the Bishop of Skalholt confirms it, the weather improves dramatically. There's a mention that the weather became better than it had been in a long time, which is the exact wrong kind of tantalizing, because how long is a long time? This feast, though, appears to be a way for Gizur to emphasize his own sanctity and power in Iceland. It is motivated out of self-interest, not care for the plight of farmers. But the most tragic consequences of this abnormal weather manifests in the narrative in 1263. At this point, only one minor family opposes Gizur's claim to Jarl, and to deal with them, Gizur rampaged through their farms in the Rangár Valley in southern Iceland, killing approximately 100 head of cattle. Sturla condemns this in the saga, writing that great suffering repaid this hostility, the translation of my title. While 100 head of cattle is significant evidence from the Maldagar or church records from later indicates that they should not be crippling. From this, we can infer that Flateyjarbókar annál was probably correct and Iceland had been suffering from famine from either the 1257 Somalis eruption or the 1262 Katla eruption. Gisser evidently does not care about the suffering of the tenant farmers of the Valley. Destroying the political opposition is his only goal. Sturtler doesn't care either until Gisser's actions worsen the crisis, and his response is a single sentence written some 30 years after the fact. When I started this project, I did hope that medieval Iceland would offer some other way of interacting with climate than we see in the present day, and it does not. But what my project does offer is a crucial insight into the limitations of our sources into high medieval Icelandic history. While severe weather crises are recorded because they are unusual, more often than not, the ideological and political goals of the narrative filter what events are recorded and to what ends. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Adam. Now I'll introduce our final speaker for today. That will be Chris Day. Chris is the head of Modern Domestic Records at the National Archives, the official archive of the UK government. He will be presenting his paper, Computing Cholera, Topic Modeling, Catalogue Entries for the Correspondence of the General Board of Health, 1848 to 1871.
So, thank you, Stephanie, and thank you to the other panelists as well for those fascinating papers. So, my paper is about topic modeling the catalogue entries for the General Board of Health between 1848 and 1871. Which probably needs some explanation by the way of what it is. So the General Board of Health was a body which was set up by the British government to try and improve the public health of England and Wales, and it operated between 1848 and 1871. The General Board regulated and advised around a thousand local boards of health throughout England and Wales in that period. Now the boards were set up in the way cholera outbreaks in England and Wales, which ran between 1831 and 1832, and also 1848 to 1849. And collectively, these outbreaks left over 100,000 people dead. Now, the boards were intended primarily to basically allow for the adoption of sewerage and water supply schemes throughout England and Wales, with the idea that this would basically help to stop the spread of cholera and other diseases through basically reducing the amount of polluted water, although the spread of disease was based on the miasma theory at the time that it was foul smells. Thankfully, the solution is the same as the germ theory. Now, they also collected information about cholera and other disease outbreaks throughout the country, approved regulations on the built environment within the country as well, and argued over the necessity of these reforms with a sometimes resistant public in Great Britain. Now, the correspondence of the General Board on these matters and all of its other work is held at the National Archives in a record series called MH13. This series consists of 272 volumes of mixed correspondence, and overall, there are 89,000, just over 89,000 individual items of correspondence, i.e. sort of what you would find inside a letter that was received by the office or their reply thereto. These records were catalogued by archive professionals, including myself, briefly, over a number of years, starting from about 2013. So now on the National Archives Catalogue Discovery, each record, each item of correspondence has a description which gives its date, its sender, its recipient, and a brief summary of its subject matter as well. So these descriptions or representations, as we would call them in archival science, of the original material, were designed to really purely to enhance human findability. The idea that when one is using the archival catalogue at the National Archives of Discovery, you could put a keyword or a name into the search box and it would return a result from MH13, which would then lead to you going to the reading rooms and examining the document. That's what those descriptions are there for, primarily, and that's what we designed for as archivists. But I suppose the question of this paper, to a certain extent, is what happens to archival research in the time of coronavirus, when we have limited access to archival material because archives are closed or their opening times are restricted? And so what I want to ask in this paper is, in the absence of being able to get into the archive for some people, what can we do with these representations of records, and how can we treat them as records of texts, as historical resources in their own right, and do research with them? Can they help us carry out historical research? And how can this approach inform historical research that we would conduct after we return to the archives after this current epidemic is over? So one way to carry out this sort of analysis and do research with these representations, with these descriptions of records, is to carry out what's referred to as distant reading. Basically, distance reading works and is designed to sort of deal with sort of analysing stuff where there is too much stuff to read in one go. So if you take the example of the 89,000 catalogue entries, there's no way that I as a human being would be able to read remember and come up with a coherent sort of idea of what everything said for all of those 89,000 catalogue entries. I just don't have the processing power in my brain really to do it in a consistent amount of time. And beyond these 89,000 catalogue entries, there's no way that a human being would be able to read all of the material that those describe. It would take too much time and we wouldn't be able to sort of hold all of those things together in our head, but a computer can do that. So distance reading, which is the opposite of sort of the close reading where one looks at a small portion of text and has a very close analysis of that, is a process of using computers to sort of, you know, read, in inverted commas, vast corpuses of text, vast amounts of different texts, and to analyze them at a sort of macro level by, you know, tabulating them, by plotting them on graphs, by visualizing them in some way, so that they can tell us about something at the whole. A very simple version of this, well, not simple version, but a clear example of this is Google Books N-gram viewer, where one can look at the frequency of the term or terms over a massive corpus of books over time, and they can tell us about the popularity of various ideas or ideologies. So another form of distant reading is something which we refer to as topic modeling, which is basically using a computer to read large corpuses of text and then using statistical models to try and group these texts by topic or subject. And that's what I want to try and do, and what I have tried to do with the catalogue entries for MH13 for the Records of the General Board of Health. So in this case, I've adopted a method of topic modeling which is referred to as latent Dirichlet allocation, which I will refer to as LDA because my French pronunciation sometimes leaves something to be asked after. So in LDA, we work under the assumption that each text has a latent or underlying topic or subject. And this is characterized by distribution of words within it and the distribution of words as across the rest of the corpus of the text that is analyzed alongside. What I do as the user before I run this algorithm is that I define what the corpus of texts are. I say these are the texts I want you to analyze and the number of topics that I expect to be underlying it. So in this case, I've said 5 just for consistency. The model then basically does quite a lot of complicated maths that I understand in a vague position, and calculates the probabilistic relationship between each of the texts and then groups them by a topic. So I'm about to share my analysis. You'll be able to see the images on the screen. I didn't go with all 89,000 catalogue entries just because I don't have the processing power to do it at scale easily. So in this paper, we'll be looking at the 2,000 or so catalogue descriptions of material, which is dated 1848, the first year of the General Board of Health's operation. And basically what I've done is sort of done some initial cleaning to the data myself, and then I've used the Python libraries GenSim and PyLDAViz to both model and visualize the corpus across 5 topics. Each topic is on a sort of 4-axis map showing where it sits in relation to the other topics and its size and importance across the entire corpus. And then on the right, there are histograms which show the most relevant terms in the topic, which sort of define its aboutness for us, really. So let's take a look at those. So topic one groups together basically text which I know to be often the first letters which are sent by towns or parishes calling for the adoption of the Public Health Act and reporting poor sanitary conditions. So you can see from it to terms like drains, sewers, nuisances. These indicate poor sanitary condition. Then we move on to topic two. It's closely linked on the map, as you can see with topic one, and the prominence of phrases like nuisance removal, regulation, power, disease prevention, border guardians, and union. These are poor law authorities, poor law union board of guardians writing into the general board to ask about their powers under the Nuisance Removal Act, a piece of sanitary legislation. Topic three, words like petition, ratepayer, and others, basically these are legalese terms. These are letters which relate to communities trying to adopt the Public Health Act through the formal process available to them. Then we move on to topic four, and you can see the promises of, for instance, the phrase case cholera and other things like that. These are letters which relate to basically reporting cases and outbreaks of cholera in communities to the board. And finally, topic five, the least prominent of the topics and also very distinct from the other ones. If you see the phrase regarding application is quite prominent there. These are job applications for people trying to become superintendent inspectors or sort of medical police for the board. So I suppose What can these tell us? Do they tell us anything new, this distant reading of the collection? And is this valid historical research? And what can it do to help us once we can get back to the archives? So I'll do those one at a time. Does it tell me anything new? I mean, I thought these would be the topics I found when I was looking at these material, but that's because I know this material very well. But what I'm hoping is that at scale, when you look at all 89,000 catalogue descriptions, you'll start to see trends emerging that possibly from the historiography I was looking at before, or my sort of bias of what I'm interested in a researcher, it will tell me, actually, you need to be looking at something else. This is prominent within the collection. And is it valid historical research if I'm using catalogue entries which were written by archivists in the 21st century, as opposed to actually looking at the 19th century documents themselves? I think so, because catalogue descriptions influence the way that we as historians access archives. They let us know that stuff is there anyway, so it's already influencing us. And getting a machine to do it on aggregate and actually say, well, these things are more common than you might have thought, is sort of in some ways more impartial than using a keyword search and just going for what I think might be there. So what I'm going to do in the future, once I can get access to the archives, and I would suggest that, you know, this is a valid approach to many archival collections, is to use this distant reading to inform us about what a collection's actually about, what's actually there, because we can have a computer to look at it whole. And then that can inform the close reading analysis that we do of the materials themselves once we can get our hands on them again. So thank you very much. And I'd just like to thank my colleagues at the National Archives for help, and also my friend Finn Dyken for his help.
Thank you so much for that paper, Chris. And thank you again to all four of our speakers today. We're now going to have a little bit of roundtable discussion before we close for the day. One place that I'd like to start is Christopher Rose actually laid out quite a useful framework for us to talk about these historical topics. So this is mostly a question for Adam and Daria, but I would like to invite Chris Day to weigh in as well with his findings in the cholera outbreaks in the 1800s. Do we see the stages that Chris Rose's paper discussed, the denial, blame, uncertainty, policy reflected in the crises that we're writing about?
I'd say that with the concern of blaming the Jews for the Black Death, specifically for the Kingdom of Castile, we don't have those records that they're blaming the Jews for poisoning the wells, for instance, that we see in Aragon or France. But what we do see is that the Jews are being blamed for what the Black Death is causing, those type of economic hardships, that the interest rate on loans are too high. But I think it's worth asking who's really being blamed here and who's being used as a political pawn, because we can directly account for what the monarch is doing in setting these interest rates. They might say the Jews are doing it, but it's really the monarch. And what are people really complaining against then? They're using the Jews as kind of a buffer against the king. But in this case, they're attacking the king as well, but they see the Jews as the king's property. So this kind of entanglement of anti-monarchical, anti-Jewish riots is very difficult to separate. But we can't possibly make those links that pandemic does lead to blaming minorities in this case, whether it's the pandemic itself or at least what it causes in war.
Mm-hmm. And Iceland, I think, takes a somewhat different approach. Certainly, part of this is due to just how scarce my source material is. I think, of all of us, I think I'm working with by far the fewest materials, with a whole grand total of 10. So I don't have just enough information to really check for the first two to see if this is, there's denial going on. Certainly, there's some amount of blame towards God in 1261. And policy coming out of that to kind of address the blame, because you can't promote violence against God, not in the 13th century Christian country. That doesn't quite work. So we see parts of the framework, and there's definitely potential for other parts of the framework to have actually appeared, but it appears that our sources, being written by elites for elites, have managed to suppress this upwelling of people that are normally left out of the historical record anyway. So any appearance that they had at the time period gets suppressed again in our surviving, I think, all of our ever created source material for the time period.
So I think in my case, the answer is probably yes and no. You do see these phases and you don't, but there's sort of one first. Cholera is quite interesting because it's a shock disease. It spreads very, very quickly once it arrives at a locality if the conditions are correct, and it can affect people very, very quickly. So you often get a very strong reaction as opposed to one of denial of people saying we must sort these things out. And that's why in 1848 you see so many letters amongst the collection I've been looking at calling for the adoption of the Public Health Act. But then it fades, and then the urgency fades, particularly amongst the wealthier people who are in control of the public policy in those local communities. And then you start to have the denial of the fact that cholera is caused by bad sanitary conditions. And also the blame. It's often blamed on in England on Irish immigration, and also on intemperance. Drunkenness is often seen as a cause for disease because it predominantly affects working class people who, because of various societal factors, are more inclined towards large-scale alcohol consumption, or the effects of it, certainly, in this period. You certainly get the uncertainty about the causes, but you do see the policy as well, as I think the fact that I'm talking about a collection of documents to do with a government policy on trying to increase public health reflects.
Yeah, actually, that reminded me, Chris, thanks for that. The severity thing is another point I wanted to kind of, I think, usefully emphasize as a difference between an epidemic and what I'm looking at with volcanism, and that it's really, really hard to just say that either a local eruption where literally the sky goes black with ash, or a global eruption that causes a terrible, terrible snowstorm, you can't say that didn't happen. It's really kind of unambiguous what's going on. The question is just how do you respond to it? So I think that's a very useful point of it's just the sheer shock value of it makes it a little bit harder to deny causes, certainly, especially when we're not looking at very, very small organisms causing that, but instead just looking at snowfall, something that's very familiar and well known.
Yeah, I think in some of the environmental cases, the sort of denial you see is that it's not that it's not happening, but it's more of the sort of what we see around the climate change debate now. It's not a big deal, right? It'll pass. So, you know, but the other thing that with Daria and Adam that I was thinking about as they were talking is, you know, we all, and all historians have to do this, you have to consider who your sources were written for, right? So, if I'm not concerned with the lives of poor people, and poor people are never going to win it, or are never going to read this document, then I'm probably not going to concern myself with wasting space, in my annal to write it down. So it raises all sorts of interesting questions about, you know, what the documentation, why the documents were created in the first place, and trying to put yourself in the headspace of the person who wrote it and ask yourself why it was created.
Yeah, I totally agree. And even though literacy is fairly high in medieval Iceland relative to the rest of Europe, which is still higher than our popular imagination by quite a lot, but we're still looking at, I don't know, I've seen estimates anywhere from 10% to almost 50% of at least basic literacy in medieval Iceland. So obviously we don't know for sure, but there's at least potential for access, and using the saga style, using this particular narrative style that's coming out of oral traditions makes it at least plausible that more people could have heard it than just the elite. But my analysis, my MA thesis goes into a lot more detail on the Icelandic saga as a whole, and it's definitely written by the very elite for the other very elite to try and make sense of what the heck just happened. Because 60 to 80 years of constant civil war takes its toll, and kind of finishing up a full history of the Free State of Iceland. So it's very specific goals that affects what he's recording. That being said, Sturla does sometimes include weather events. There's like a 1220 eruption in Reykjanes that he just includes because he thinks it's a significant event, not for any political reason. So there is definitely within the text room for negotiation and room for these markers of the things that people will remember regardless of their social station. So it's a really complicated question, but one that hopefully my paper tries to tease out a little bit.
And that kind of leads me into another question about sources, particularly for the medievalists. I'm a medievalist as well, and a lot of the time I'm dealing with people writing considerably after the fact, sometimes even a generation away. For example, in the 1130s, one of my sources writes about an eclipse, and writing about it a few years later, they categorize it as being an omen of all the bad things that are to come. How does the distance between when the events were happening and when your sources are written? I know that Daria, as well as Adam, touched on a little bit how the distance of sources changes how events are reported.
I think it can be helpful in some ways in kind of unearthing what might be going on, or how an idea that seems like a kernel of what might be budding might be able to help us understand what happens in later periods. So in the chronicle written by Pero Lopez de Ayala about Pedro I's reign, it's just a typical royal chronicle. There's a very kind of cool and nonchalant attitude towards the anti-Jewish riots. They happened because people wanted to do it, which isn't very helpful for historians. But when we read a later poem by Pero Lopez de Ayala, the same person, he starts talking about the Jews as if they're nobles, with the same grievances that peasants would have towards the nobles, that they're abusive, they're taking all of our money, they're just using us for the sake of the king and for the crown treasury or the nobility treasury. Instead of nobles, we just see Jews. So we can see that maybe what we see in the chronicle written a lot closer to the Civil War might not be as useful as something that's written later on that maybe they didn't want us to link, that maybe Enrique and his supporters, as well as Pedro I, were contributing to this idea of anti-Judaism. And then we get into, who's able to write at this time. We have a lot of literature written by Jewish scholars in Hebrew. And this is how we unearth this type of privilege that Christians may think of the Jewish relationship with the king. In a piece by Moses HaKohen of Tordesillas, which is called Support of the Faith. It's a polemical debate, but also touches on a lot of political and social issues between Christians and Jews. He's almost pleading with Christians, please don't take this as a privilege with the king. You have to understand we pay for this. It's in our taxes, where we don't have a choice but to support the king. And he attributes a lot of the violence in the Civil War is that, well, we had two kings at the time, Enrique and Pedro I, and no one was protecting us. They were just vying for power. So we have to, it's not always a sign of the archives, but it's picking archives. Middle Ages is usually dominated by Latin, but why not read Hebrew? Why not read Arabic if these sources are useful to us, even written 10 or 8 years after something happens?
Yeah, I totally agree with that. Definitely, there's this idea that the closer a source is, the better it is, but I think that's fairly straightforwardly not always true, or not always the most helpful way to approach the material. Because a real problem with, of course, looking at the Icelandic Middle Ages is that manuscripts don't tend to survive for very long in Iceland because it is so wet all the time, and storage conditions just don't exist until very recently in the country. And so a lot of the stuff is looking at copies of copies of copies, often made in the 18th, 19th, even 20th century, of a text composed in the 13th century. And so there's a lot of work that's been done and continues to be done on just trying to understand how distance from the time period actually impacts it, and how is it more complicated than just closer sources better. And we have no truly contemporary sources of the Sturlungaöld. Sturla's Icelandic saga is the closest, written within at the end of Sturla's life. So after he's had time to think back and kind of understand everything that's happening. But I think, Chris Day, like, this kind of reflects the thing you said of, can we use 21st century archival catalogs as valid sources for the 19th century or the 15th century or whatever time period we want? And I think the answer is, as always, yes, we totally can. And just as long as we're being careful to understand where the source is created and why the source is created, then you can do a lot of really cool things without relying on needing an eyewitness event, and it still does really valuable historical analysis.
I think that's a really interesting point. I mean, so I was occasionally envious of medievalist friends in that, you know, they don't have quite the panoply of sources that I would have to wade through in some cases, although I'm sure it comes with its own struggles, as has been highlighted by other panelists. But there's that interesting thing about, you know, being aware of your sources and being, you know, particularly the distance of the events they describe, but also being aware of the biases and sort of the tools you use to find your sources, I think, which is what my paper picked up on to a certain extent, because I asked the question of, you know, when we use catalogue entries as a source that are written a long time after the events they describe, but someone else reading the material, that sort of level of interaction. When I was doing it, I had to ask myself the question, is this a valid thing to do? But it's made me realise that actually, you know, whether as critically as they should do or not, historians are always using these abstractions, these representations of sources to direct their research, because otherwise we wouldn't know they were there. We're using library catalogue descriptions to decide which book we should read. You know, we're using archival catalogues to find our material, or calendars that were written in the 19th century, where people have very different perceptions of what a source should be about and what's important. And so I think it's something that it's sort of incumbent on all of us who study history to think about, you know, what are the biases in the things I use to actually find my sources, let alone the biases of the sources themselves. It's a real sort of Pandora's box, I think, but it's fascinating.
Yeah, this has been an issue for me because right now getting into archives in, well, anywhere in the Eastern Mediterranean is just a bit problematic. So a lot of times the catalog entries are the only things you have because the material that is referred to no longer exists, or nobody knows where it is, or it's in a private collection that's not cataloged or something. And so just literally having an indication that at some point somebody wrote something about it sometimes is just a little push you need to realize that, okay, somebody thought this event was significant enough to write about it, even if I don't know what they said. So it's enough to answer the question of, is there a there, to set you down a journey. A lot of times, I mean, even up to the early 20th century, I started life as a medievalist actually, and then, realized that most of the sources for the Middle East in Arabic, a lot of them are written in poetic format, and I couldn't do poetic Arabic. So I wound up working on the 19th and early 20th century. But, you know, even for that time period, there's still these massive gaps. And I've been to your workplace, and somebody will very helpfully ask me if I've been to the archives in Cairo. And it's like, well, no, I can't get there. But, you know, so it's like half the collection is in London from the colonial period and half the collection's in Cairo. But these are all things that we have to work with. I was just thinking about this yesterday because I was on the subreddit, right? Responding to a thread, and everyone's very positivist in the way they approach things. You know, it's like, are there documents about this? I think the question about, you know, is there documentation for the life of Jesus comes up like three times a week on Ask Historians, and it's like. No, but that doesn't mean nothing, you know? So it's like, these are questions that we all play with. And I think sometimes think that this is the sort of stuff that we need to be talking about more publicly, is, you know, how we have to play with these things in order to figure things out, because we don't have those sorts of texts.
I super agree. And that reminds me of something I didn't even touch on in my paper is, of course, we have two main strands of transmission for the saga I talk about, which are somewhat radically different at times. And so it would just be a really cool follow-up to try and use some of the methodologies you talked about, Chris Day, with your using the LDA or other statistical models as a way to kind of just look at manuscript variation. Because, you know, you talked about the problem of archives being like no way to read 89,000 sources effectively. I mean, I think 15 of Íslendinga saga, but at 200 chapters long, it's not entirely feasible to read 15 copies from across six centuries of a changing language either. So definitely is a place where I think your methodology is incredibly cool for the 19th century. And I think it also has a lot of utility for looking way earlier, even for the medievalists, with our blessing ? Of having very few sources.
I mean, I think it's something which is really applicable for lots of things, and certainly I think distant reading was sort of, the idea was kind of a guy called Franco Moretti, who wrote an article about 2001 about this, and his basically his starting point was, you know, I'm considered to be a literature scholar, but actually if you take me outside of sort of a couple of decades and a couple of writers in Germany in the 19th century, then I'm pretty lost. And there's no way I'm going to read enough books, let alone understand them, to be able to improve that. But I can get, you know, I can start to look at the difference between a whole sort of world of literature using the computer to do it for me. He didn't actually say how we would go about doing that. That sort of followed afterwards. And LDA itself, I think, was initially a genetic modeling technique, which some people sort of repurposed in the last sort of 20 years. And that textual difference, it really sort of is helpful. And that's sort of what I realized when I was doing this. And I don't think what I'm doing is new. Maybe using catalogue descriptions is slightly more novel than some colleagues have been doing with digitized text, but they're often the only machine readable text we have available for collections. And to do transcription, as we all know, is sometimes quite difficult, although handwritten text recognition is improving. And it's basically this way, as you say, of doing quite quickly, you know, if you've got sort of 12 different versions of a saga, you can quite quickly, without having to read all of the pages every time, do this very close analysis, work out sort of visually in a way which is easily understandable to the human eye what the differences might be, and that can inform the bits you actually do then go close read and do that analysis on. So yeah, it's a great technique, which I'm really enjoyed doing.
Yes, I completely agree with Adam as well. I've had that issue reading medieval chronicles, and especially I studied 12th century England and France, where it's estimated that only about 10% of the total written work from that period actually survives. But on top of that, you will get versions of the same chronicle that were maybe altered or corrected. So you might have one version earlier that says one thing, but perhaps after the king has changed, you know, maybe the son has inherited, or particularly surrounding the English anarchy in the 1130s and 40s, you get a lot of people kind of retroactively changing sides in their documentation. And I wanted to ask if you see that appear in some of your documents. I had that question for both Adam and Daria.
I don't see a whole lot. There is definitely some, like some of the late copies of Sturlunga saga, the whole compilation, including both of the sagas I talked about in my paper, are sometimes quite significantly different after the thing gets compiled around 1300. But there's also a lot of continuity. And I mean, textual variation is still a very emergent field in Old Norse studies in general. So we kind of have to, there's a lot more research that needs to be done in order to be able to confidently answer that question either way. And especially to look at that and to then take that variation and see how on a very specific level of looking at environmental information or epidemics, even just like annual instances of the Black Death in the early 1400s in Iceland. I think more work needs to be done before I can confidently say, yes, there's textual variation in a significant way, or no, there really isn't. So yeah, a very good non-answer, as with so many things in medieval studies still.
I think there's definitely a retelling of why the Civil War started. I think it might also due to where the chronicle originates from, in the sense that in Castile we don't have yet saying that Pedro I is, you know, the son of a Jewish mother until until the Trust Damrin and Burgundian house are reunited through a marriage. So that's Pedro I's original house. But we do see it a lot earlier in France, for instance. The writer Bertrand de Guesclin doesn't even acknowledge that Enrique is an illegitimate child. It's switched. Pedro I is illegitimate, and by that way, his mother was Jewish. Alfonso XI wanted a son, and so he was desperate in trade with the Jewish woman. And Enrique is the true son, and he's a Catholic crusader. We didn't have the reconquest during this time either, so there's a lot of reinvention. And we also have a retelling on how Enrique kills Pedro I. So in the original chronicle, it's Bertrand de Guesclin kind of betrays Pedro I and helps Enrique kill him. Enrique doesn't even notice or recognize Pedro I because it's been such a long war, versus in the French chronicles, in some of the French chronicles, it says before killing Pedro Fresnevique calls him the son of a Jewish whore, is a translation. So we see a lot of, well, what did he actually say and what did he mean? And did he use anti-Jewish propaganda? We can't prove it, but some of the chronicles either is just reinterpreting it radically because of the French treatment of the Jews, or maybe it's just something that the Trastevere burns and we don't have access to in Castile. But what we can say is that there was a shift by the reign of Enrique II, which is not entirely useless in connecting the dots.
Yeah, this is an interesting question. I actually noticed it myself because what first sent me down the road of epidemics in the first place was the cholera of 1883, because it broke out about 18 months after the British had occupied Egypt. They showed up, they occupied the country in January of 1882. And so it was really their first sort of crisis. And the way they dealt with things was by complaining about how Egyptians were dirty, and they lived in filth, which in the 19th century was very specifically organic excrement. It was not a synonym for dirt the way it is now. The way the British dealt with things was that they really just were being, their official line was that cholera was not contagious. It was spread by miasma. This was not settled science at this point. There were a lot of people who felt otherwise, but it would have harmed trade with coming out of India. If it's like, well, your ships are bringing it from India. It first showed up in Egypt in a port city where the ships coming out of the Suez Canal into the Mediterranean would call to take on supplies, and the soldiers would come, or the sailors would come aboard. So they were burning poor neighborhoods, just, you know, evicting everybody, not providing new housing or compensating them for the loss, but they're like, your neighborhood's dirty, we're going to burn it down. And people started to protest. And then it like 6 months later, the German team comes out and says, well, actually we found the causal agents. And the about face in the documentation, because you have the Lancet and the British Medical Journal, who are both, you know, they meet one of them, I cannot for the life of me remember which one off the top of my head, turns on the British Ministry of Health immediately, and the other one keeps trying to support him. So then you have this war between the two prominent medical journals for the British medical community about contagionism versus anti-contagionism. And the way it affects policy was just fascinating. This is actually what led me down the road to, what can this tell us about, you know, social protests over health decisions? Because it was just fascinating the way that, you know, as you write, they couldn't rewrite history because they'd been so prolific in their denunciations, but they just sort of got this collective amnesia and pretended that what they'd written 6 months earlier wasn't there anymore.
I mean, this is, you know, there are definitely counter narratives of just sort of thinking about the experience of cholera in the British Isles slightly earlier in 1883. But there's a real cognitive dissonance about the spread of contagion to a certain extent, because there's a clear awareness that these things are brought in by ports of entry, certainly in the case of 1831, 1832. We're pretty sure it came in into Gateshead in Northumberland via a ship from the Baltic, it seems to be the thing. But there's also this idea that, you know, disease is spread by the miasma, by sort of foul air or foul smells. And indeed, you know, certainly in Britain, it's well known, John Snow, who basically maps the Broad Street cholera outbreak and sort of comes up with the fact that it is spread by water and the beginning of germ theory. William Farr, who is quite a senior sort of disease modeler who works for the Registrar General, sort of goes against that and sort of carries on miasma, although some decades later he sort of comes round to Snow's way of thinking. But certainly in Britain, you know, the miasma theory remained dominant throughout the 19th century. And as I said in my paper, it's just lucky that getting rid of smells, the method is the same way that one supplies people with clean drinking water and ensues that they're not living, as Chris Rose says, surrounded by filth in the most euphemistic way possible, describing it. But you do get that in local communities. I mean, the material I'm looking at, it's, this form of sort of local governance and having the built environment regulated is quite unusual in Britain at this point. And so there's a lot of reaction against it because it's central government intervening in your business. And there's a lot of letters about how this undermines people's Anglo-Saxon liberty, and how it's the tyranny of centralization, and how it will cost too much. And they often argue that the cost of paying the local rates to build these sewers will actually cause a higher mortality than cholera itself, despite the fact that they have massive excess death rates, not just from cholera, but from things like typhus that we know as well is caused by unsanitary environments. I suppose in a way they're right, though, because actually this sort of ushers in a sort of more modern form of local government. They can remake streets and things. So it has that lasting effect. And I suppose that last stage of what you were talking about, Chris, that policy stage, says epidemics fundamentally change the social fabric and sort of political fabric of Britain, in the case of cholera, by ushering in this sort of new way of organising communities, however sort of unsuccessful and contested it is to begin with in this case.
Yeah, one thing that's shocking to me is just how long miasma theory kind of endures. Because, to bring in a completely unrelated time period, in the 15th, 16th, and early 17th century, in the recurring waves of the Second Plague Pandemic, people do realize that quarantine is the thing that stops it from spreading, and public health measures in both England and in Denmark, for instance, become fairly sophisticated and really quite aggressive. And yet, it's like there's this philosophical underpinnings, despite still being contradictory with public health practice, seem to almost like take charge again going later. And it's a really weird kind of, I guess, reversal of the policy or the uncertainty, where despite something being demonstrated to be effective repeatedly for centuries, the thing that doesn't account for that at all continues to remain really prominent in imagination and in medical research. It's really weird to me.
It's interesting you mention that because, humoric medicine stuck around for a very long time as well. The idea that an imbalance of the bodily humors was responsible for things. And I have this theory, and I nothing particularly academic, but it must have had some bearing on what people were observing, because theories like that don't stick around for 2,000 years unless somebody is thinks they actually work, right? There must have been something to it. It turns out that not mixing the sewage with the water that's coming in the house for drinking is good for the health. It just, nobody really understood why, I guess. But
I suppose it's a question of perception. I mean, and I think other people have probably done work on this, and this is just based on my own sort of vague readings and some wild theories I'm going to posit. But I suppose no one can see bacteria or viruses, as we know from our current worries and the reason why we're doing conferences online, I suppose. Whereas, most people can smell. And as Chris says, as I think we've discussed, possibly one of the reasons why it sticks around is because often the solution for one is the same when it comes to waterborne or dirtborne diseases. So I suppose based on what you could observe, you might think, well, I've got rid of the smell and people are less sick, so it's probably the smell, despite what this guy in London who's made a weird map with blobs around it says. We know this has worked before. That's just sort of speculation on my part.
Yeah, that pretty well gels with my understandings of just medieval medicine too. It's odd when the practice explicitly contradicts the academic understanding that both coexist for so long. Because of course, under humoral theory, quarantine does literally nothing, and yet they did quarantines anyway.
Yeah, I think the other thing that we all tend to not pay attention to, but it is lurking in the background, is usually the most popular solution is whichever one costs less, right? Involves the least amount of disruption. Doing nothing or putting somebody up in an island off the coast, for 40 days where they have to bring their own food, is doesn't affect the people on the mainland. So it's easier to just, okay, you go do that and we'll play over here and we'll see you in a month, that sort of thing.
So one thing I wanted to circle back to is for everyone, is the question that is central to Chris Day's paper about the validity of cataloging sources by essentially machine means, how valid is that for researchers to utilize when they're putting together their sources for academic research? And I also wanted to touch on, does that cataloging method, whether it's done by a person or by a computerized system like Christe was talking about, does that become part of the source? And you know, how are we going to be studying how that was done, 20 years from now?
I'll leap into the fray here. So I don't know. So I don't know that it's going to become part of the source, because there is the new and emerging field of information studies, which is where people literally study how those things are done. But one of the things that excites me about projects like this is that you now have the ability to, for example, crowdsource annotations of these sorts of things. So it's like you have the machine, the machine generated, okay, I should look at this document because this word appears so many times. But then, you could actually at this point, have somebody who looked at the physical thing, a researcher, come in and say, okay, I'm going to write up a short summary of what it is that I've looked at. And then you can get more and more of the documents a little more complete in the system, because you can actually involve the research, the end users of these archival documents, the people who are looking at them at a table, to tell you what they are. It takes some of the work off of the archivists as well, because you can now involve them in everybody can be involved in the conversation. That's one of the nice things about the sort of proliferation of digital materials online, is you can actually add to the entry, right? And say, oh yeah, I looked at this, and this is what's interesting, and it ties into this, which is something that the archivist, who may not specialize in that particular field, may not necessarily know off the top of their head. So I that's one of the neat things about where the new information technology is going, from my.
So I suppose this is really interesting. So I mean, like, you ask if these things, these representations of sources are going to become sources in their own right. I would argue that they probably already are, and that's an interesting thing. Because archiving is very subjective, it's not a passive process. One of my former colleagues, Richard Dunley, has just written an article recently about the gaps one finds in the Foreign Office archive, for the UK, the Edwardian Forest Office archive. And a lot of that is based on what material was considered not to be worthy of historical preservation by the Foreign Office in the 1920s. That's caused gaps in the archive. And then the way it's being catalogued causes people to study certain things. So, we can't read the history of things where they're not there, where there are silences. Not to get overly technical, but Jack Derrida in Archive Fever, sort of text and archival theory, he sort of says the archivization produces as much as it is sort of, as much as anything else, it's an active process. And with, people increasingly sort of doing big data with web pages, these catalog entries are going to be available to look at. So we have to interrogate them as a critical source ourselves. And whether we can just do that with the machine or not, I think we need both. We can have that big aggregate picture by sort of getting machine to read things. But I mean, as I've shown those charts I did in my paper, if I didn't understand the source material, they wouldn't really mean anything to anybody really without someone to explain them. So we need that expert knowledge too, which is, as Chris Rose says, that's where the web is a really great tool for us, because we can have this crowdsourcing and have people who really know what they're doing correcting the machine, so making analysis better and better and better, and improving the way that we can understand our own sources when we come to look at them, sort of taking out maybe some of that legwork we have to slog through, dozens of documents where it turns out we didn't need to read them. Not that that's not part of the fun of researching archives anyway. So
Yeah, and I wanted to spin off Chris Rose's point too, because I think that's a really important and good one, because one of the problems I have when looking at like either library archives or the Alfred Magnuson Institute for Icelandic Studies manuscript catalogs is that the catalog material often is fairly superficial in what it's actually recording in the sources, and when something like I've demonstrated being a literary narrative source of political history that also has a ton of environmental information buried in it. It's something that the catalogue maybe doesn't actually represent, and so for certainly less organized catalogues and less concrete corpuses of just information is kind of a risk of using these catalogues, I think, maybe for the distant reading of just what information is actually getting recorded, especially for us looking at environmental, past environments, past disease. It just may not be information there may be information in sources that is useful to us that the catalog in no way, shape, or form represents. But Chris Rose, I think your suggestion is hugely important for that. If we have a way to go into the catalogs and say, by the way, as environmental historians, here's a whole bunch of useful, this source, and this source are all super duper useful for us and improve the catalog that way, I think that's a really, really fascinating way to improve this distance reading on a very broad, almost interdisciplinary level.
I mean, for sure. I mean, yeah, I should probably add a caveat to my remarks as well about, yeah, as you were saying, Adam, about the ability to distant read. I mean, I should really point out to anybody watching that the catalogue entries I'm working with are remarkably detailed compared to a lot of the way archival sources are catalogued. And that in itself skews the way that archival catalogues show up the relevance of material, because there's more information about some things. And what gets described better is often skewed by sort of contemporary priorities. So my organisation gained funding, very, very generous funding from the Wellcome Trust to get its material catalogued. And they are interested in researching medical humanities and history. But there's other material that maybe there's not so many generous organisations that give grants for things to be catalogued in. So that influences what can be distance read and what we find when we look at catalogues. And so it's not a panacea, but if we're critical about knowing about what is well described, then we can use it in some fields, I think.
All right. So if we don't have any further thoughts on that topic, we are coming to the close of our allotted time. So I just want to thank all of our panelists again for joining us and having this great discussion about environmental disaster, epidemic, and how we talk about those topics as historians. I want to thank all of our panelists today. I want to thank our Ask Historians mods for putting their time in to organize this entire conference. And this is great. And we want to thank everybody on the Ask Historian subreddit who's watching, and we hope to see you in the questions thread that this will be posted with.